Hello, everyone. I am Rodney Wallace. I'm the director of BARDA's Detection, Diagnostics, and Devices Infrastructure Division. Tell you a little bit today about what DDDI is up to. So first of all, DDDI addresses diagnostic needs and medical device needs across all of BARDA's threat space. For CBRN threats, we develop antimicrobial resistance diagnostics, we develop biothreat diagnostics, and we develop biodosimetry systems. For influenza, we obviously develop influenza diagnostics in multiple different types and kinds. For emerging disease, we develop diagnostics for Zika, Ebola, and COVID-19 so far. DDDI also develops diagnostics across all of this threat space for multiple use cases. The use cases vary from home use and tests that can be used in remote settings to point of care, doctor's offices, nursing homes. Tests can be used in those settings. And then, of course, the foundation of all testing is laboratory diagnostics, and we fund development of specialized diagnostics for those needs as well. Oops, sorry, wrong way. So far, DDDI has funded developers, many of you, to achieve 31 clearances or approvals for diagnostic tests, 12 of which were this year. About half of those are COVID tests, and half of them are tests that were already in the pipeline before COVID distracted us all and were in the approval process with FDA. So an amazing bumper crop of approvals for us this year. DDDI has also funded developers to achieve 41 emergency use authorizations. Prior to COVID, all of those have translated into clearances or approvals. After COVID, they won't all translate into clearances or approvals because the market needs for COVID testing have evolved as the disease has persisted for a good while now. So a good number of them will translate to clearances, but not all. I want to thank all of you for all of the work that was done to achieve these clearances. We did a lot of work, and y'all did a whole lot more. So thank you very much. Whoops, I can't go the right way. A little bit on our COVID response. So we had over 500 engagements with industry, many of which were in the year of 2020. We funded development of more than 65 products. The continued impact, 8 of those have achieved clearances so far. We have 33 EUAs to date. Though it is a little rare for us to do this, we also invested in expanding domestic diagnostic test manufacturing capacity in the country. And we completed 6 expansions over the past year, and that resulted in a capacity of 72 million additional tests per month should we need them. Future impact. We currently have 4 pathogen-specific coronavirus tests in development. We'll talk a little bit more about four pathogen family tests in development. We'll talk more about that in a minute. We have over 18 COVID flu combo products in development. We learned early in 2020 the importance of only having a single testing action to get to differentiate both flu and COVID. And then we have so far invested in 10 home use diagnostic platforms. All right, so enough about what we've done. Now let's talk about where we're going. So as Kim and others talked about back in September of 2020, the White House published an update to the National Biodefense Strategy. It's available on their website. Strongly recommend you get a copy and read it. Not just the first few pages, go to the back where the good stuff is, at least if you're interested in the diagnostic space. So there are 3 key goals for diagnostics for humans in the NBS. The first one is to have threat agnostic testing available within 12 hours of a determination that there is a significant new pathogen emerging that's a risk to human health. To have pathogen specific tests available within 30 days in quantity, and to have point of need tests for use at homes, nursing homes, remote settings within 90 days. Those are all substantially faster than tests were available during COVID-19. So how are we going to do this? So also in the NBS, this graph describes the process that we're going to use. There will be ongoing next generation metagenomic sequencing surveillance ongoing around the world. A lot of it in the United States, some of it in other countries. Periodically, there'll be a hit of a new disease that might be a risk for human health. In most cases, it'll be determined that those not going to be a big risk, that yes, we'll see some people with that disease, but it's not going to be a big problem. But should we determine that there is a significant public health emergency emerging, then a determination will be that a response is needed, similar to the COVID outbreak response. Now, not all responses are the same size. Some are medium, some are small, some are big. BARDA's development efforts going forward are going to be focused on the middle of this slide, which is the activities needed for diagnostics to inform and care of people following this determination that there is a significant biological threat emerging. To zoom in on that activity a little bit, I give you this slide. So again, on the far left, there is an emerging pathogen has been identified. There's been a process that has gone on to determine that there's a significant threat emerging. And that determination has been, yes, there is. Down at the bottom, you'll know that there's a period that's called activation time. That's an important time, so remember that for later when I talk about it. So the goals say, within 12 hours, we have to have threat agnostic testing up and running. We're going to achieve that with two kinds of tests. The first are next generation sequencing based diagnostic tests to be performed mostly at diagnostic laboratories. And then the second group are pathogen family tests to be performed at point of care settings. No home use yet. Within 30 days, which is substantially faster than we were able to achieve during COVID, we're being asked to have diagnostic tests that are specific to the new threat available starting at 30 days, and to have those in substantial volume. Within 90 days, then we have to have those tests available for home use, for physicians' offices, for nursing homes, for all of the remote settings. It's going to be a big lift. So how are we going to do this? Well, first, threat agnostic testing, or NGS-based testing. Our plan is, and by the way, this is our plan. This is not guaranteed to be what FDA approves. But our plan is to first develop NGS-based diagnostic tests that will identify known pathogens. We can't do all pathogens at once, so we're going to start off with viral pathogens and viral respiratory pathogens. We're going to get that test approved and available to use. I'm sorry, I said approved. I should have said cleared and ready to use. Sorry. Then when the new disease is emerging, during that activation time I was talking about, we're going to execute a pre-approved change protocol. And again, of course, this will be with FDA's blessing, but a pre-approved change protocol that will allow us to add that pathogen to the already cleared test, and therefore we'll have cleared testing up and running right then. And we think we can do that testing very quickly in just days. We'll see if it works out. The next tool I talked about was pathogen family tests. Now, these are tests that will be cleared in advance of any outbreak for different pathogen families. As I'll talk about more, we right now have coronavirus pathogen family tests and influenza family tests in development. These panels are made up of, number one, a test that says, oh, this pathogen in this patient's blood is somewhere in the genomic continuum of, let's use coronavirus to make the talking easy, coronavirus. And then we'll have specific tests for every known human coronavirus in the panel. The way the test is used is, if the PAN test comes back positive and all the known human tests come back negative, there's a pretty good chance this patient's infected with a new emerging coronavirus we're worried about. It's not absolutely definitive, but we'd love to have it in 2020. Very much. Okay. So that's the pathogen family tests. Next, pathogen-specific tests. Everybody knows what these are. We've been doing these for years. How in the world can we do it in 30 days? Well, the first thing we're going to have to do is cheat. We're going to start before somebody decides this is going to be a big deal. Okay, so we've got to use some of that pre-activation time I talked about earlier to get those test developments started. We're also going to look for opportunities to speed up the process of develop pathogen-specific tests. BARDA is going to continue our investment in home-use molecular diagnostic tests, and we're also going to look at opportunities to develop highly sensitive antigen tests. The antigen tests we used during COVID were very helpful, but to be honest, they're not that sensitive. We really could use something a little better next time. Molecular home use tests are very sensitive, but they're expensive to develop. And so far, manufacturing capacity is limited. We're going to be working to expand our ability to multiplex these tests. Some of the currently available tests only do one or two tests. That's all the platform can do. We're going to make that bigger. Two important things we want to enable. First of all is test to treat scenarios where patients that have trouble getting to where they can receive healthcare can get testing done and drugs in one stop. The second one is we want to really empower televisits to doctors. You know, it'd be great when you're calling your doctor, you already have a test result you want to tell them about. We hope to achieve that. Another initiative, this is just a pre-glimpse that we hope to launch. There's still a lot of approval to be done. We don't have a solicitation out yet. Is a program we're calling DXR2, which is Diagnostic Rapid Response Capability. This is going to be focused on biothreat diagnostics. We have a real problem of getting companies interested in developing biothreat diagnostics only because the markets are small for those kind of tests. We're hoping that this program will help speed that up, so stay tuned for that. Antimicrobial resistance diagnostics is going to remain very important for us. Our objective is right antibiotic first time. We're not there yet, or first prescription. We're not there yet. We're funding five programs, informatics for viral versus bacterial diagnostics, DNA electronics for molecular markers of resistance through next generation sequencing, and three phenotypic AST platforms, BioMérieux's specific diagnostics test, Beckman Coulter's improvement to their platform, and the CellX diagnostics platform that we've been funding for many years. So, first of all, our definition of long-term is very different than Kemp's, because hers was long. I would think in more of 5 years time frame. So, first of all, near-term, we have a bunch of COVID-19 510Ks to continue to fund, and we're going to continue with the developers to achieve those clearances where appropriate. Number two, we want to take multiplex capability up on home-use molecular diagnostics. Number three, we're going to be investing in more pathogen family diagnostic test panels. number four. We're going to develop tools to support use of next-generation sequencing as a diagnostic tool. Medium term, we expect to get clearance for thread-agnostic viral respiratory pathogen diagnostics using NGS sequencing. Number two, I can't hardly read my slide. We're going to drive down the manufacturing cost of home-use molecular diagnostics. Right now, the prices on those tests are too high. We're hopeful we reduce the cost, we reduce the price. And then we're looking to continue investment and achieving results in direct from sample AST platforms. Long term, again, more like 5 years, we want to have thread agnostic pathogen identification testing available. We want to expand available biothreat diagnostics in part through this DX rapid response capability, if we get to go forward with it. I also was remiss in not thanking those of you that filled out our RFI we put out back in summer, July, for the responses. Those are extremely helpful for us to define this program. So thank you very much. All right, so if you want to learn more about the DDDI programs going forward, here are some of our sessions. We have I can't quite read it anymore. We have sessions tomorrow morning at, I can't read the time, so hopefully y'all can. Thank you.